Welcome back to Chemistry Matters. With all we've learned so far about matter's physical and chemical properties and how different types of matter mix together, you're ready to learn how to separate the chemicals in those mixtures. So let's get back to our classroom and see how our students are using physical properties to separate chemicals.
These bowls of candy can be a great model for separating water from other materials in a mixture. Go ahead and separate the purple pieces of candy. We'll pretend they're water molecules. The other colors represent all the other things that might be mixed in the water. If we remove all the purple candies and put them in one pile, you'll see that the other pile has all the other colors in it. Those could be sand, dirt, trash, and all the other stuff you find in water. They're all mixed together. All the pure water has been separated out. In some water solutions, though, we can't simply reach our fingers in and pull molecules out one by one. But because we understand the physical properties of water, we can indeed separate water safely.
Can all mixtures be easily separated?
Good question. It depends on the mixture. Some mixtures, like drum cymbals, are difficult to separate without high temperature melting and industrial processes. But as for mixtures that can be easily separated, let's take a look at this sand and iron mixture. Using the magnetic physical properties of iron filings, try to use these magnets here to separate out the iron filings.
Oh, that's pretty cool.
Because the mixtures are made up of substances that combine physically, we can use physical processes to separate mixtures. Check this out. Since liquids can have different densities, as you see in this combination of red water and yellowish vegetable oil, it's pretty easy to separate the oil, which floats on top from the water because it's denser than oil. See how only the red water pours out? Let's try some other physical processes that can be used to separate mixtures. Have any of you ever squeezed juice from an orange or had fresh squeezed orange juice? Ever notice the pulp?
Ugh, I hate pulp.
Well, if we squeeze the juice from an orange, we get residual pieces of the orange's flesh in the juice. Now, is the orange juice with pulp a homogeneous or a heterogeneous mixture?
It's a heterogeneous mixture. We can see the pieces of the pulp.
Right. Some people like pulp. However, we can use a strainer to get the pieces out. Watch. We can even use filter paper to separate the pulp. The strainer and the filter paper both have small holes that let the liquid drip through, but the filter paper has holes that are microscopically small.
We call the process our teacher just demonstrated filtration. Filtration is a physical process used to separate solids from liquids by passing them through a barrier. The barrier, called a filter, allows small particles to pass through while larger particles are blocked. Filtration is used to separate heterogeneous mixtures. A porous barrier is used to separate a solid from a liquid. Our porous barrier is the strainer and this filter paper. Special filters can even separate gases. Another way to separate water and other liquids is by using distillation. Distillation is the process that separates homogeneous mixtures based on the different boiling points of the substances. It boils the liquid from the other components, and then a tube carries the gas off to a place where it can condense. The mixture is heated until the substance with the lowest boiling point boils to a vapor, which can then be condensed into a liquid and collected.
Does anybody know of anything that's distilled?
I actually use distilled water to clean my contact lenses.
Oil, like making gasoline. I heard oil refineries in Louisiana use distillation to separate different liquids from oil.
That's true, good job. Distilling gasoline from crude oil is really hard to do, so careful safety rules have to be followed when you're distilling oil at a refinery. Kerosene, gasoline, jet fuel, and other substances in crude oil boil at different temperatures. That's how a refinery separates them. Now, what would we do if we want to separate a pure solid from a solution in which the substance is dissolved? For example, if we had a big container of juice from a sugarcane plant, and I wanted to collect the solid, pure sugar crystals.
If we boil the juice, the water will boil, and the vapor will go into the air, right?
Right. Boiling or evaporating from a sugar or salt solution will make the water go into the air, leaving solid crystals behind. That's called crystallization, which separates a pure solid substance from a solution containing the dissolved substance.
We can see crystallization in evaporating seawater. In this photo, you see what happens near the Dead Sea in Israel when water evaporates from the seawater, leaving salt crystals behind. The seawater is a homogeneous mixture with a high concentration of salt dissolved in it. So, during the day when the sun is shining bright, evaporation takes place where the water moves from the liquid state to being a gas. In particular, near the shore, this change of concentration from the water being evaporated causes the salt to recrystallize and form salt pits on the seashore. If water from evaporation is collected, we can use that water for human water supplies. This purification process is called desalination, and this process certainly produces very high-quality drinking water in desert locations. But desalination is a really expensive way to purify water. It can be difficult to separate solids dissolved into liquids on a large scale. So let's get back to our classroom and learn about some other separation methods.
A different method for separating dissolved materials is called chromatography. In chromatography, the parts of a mixture are separated based on the ability of each dissolved component to travel through materials at different speeds. Let's go back to our candies to explore chromatography. It'll be tempting, but be sure not to eat your equipment before the experiment, okay? You'll have a piece of filter paper or a coffee filter. Now, use a pencil to trace a circle approximately 3 centimeters in diameter. Now, write the numbers around the edge of the filter paper for each of the substances to be tested. In this chromatography demonstration, you'll use chemicals found in candy and drink mixes. You can also do this with the ink for markers, different types of pens, or even leafy vegetables. We'll see if chromatography can separate the different chemicals used to make candy coloring. Combine the drink mixture with a few drops of water and then make a thick, wet paste. Now add 1 drop of water to each of the candies. For each of the 3 substances to be tested, place a small dot on the penciled line by dipping a toothpick into the colored liquid to be tested and touching the paper. Allow the spot to dry and re-spot it in the same position. Now, use a pencil to punch a hole in the center of the filter paper. Now, insert a folded piece of filter paper into the hole as a wick. Add water to these beakers. Set the wick into the water with the filter paper resting on top of the dish. Water should move up the wick and onto the coffee filter. The chemicals that dissolved in water will move up with the water onto the filter. Large molecules won't be able to move as far as small molecules, so mixtures will separate in the paper. Don't rush this. It's a fun experiment. I know you can handle it.
Now that our teacher has given you the instructions for setting up this experiment, let's take a break and let you get to work and record your own results by drawing a picture of your chromatogram. Oh, I forgot to tell you, a chromatogram is a piece of paper on which a solution has been separated. That's what our teacher just described. And here's an important tip. For accurate data, make sure you remove the chromatogram from the dish before the water reaches the edge of the filter paper. Good luck with that, and I'll see you at the top of the next video for Unit 2.